Mr. Taru, in this video, we're going to take a look at two examples of solving for the missing parts of oblique triangles using either law of cosine or law of sine. Actually, it's going to be a lot of law of cosine because that is what the point of this video is, to introduce the law of cosine. In the description, you'll find a link to my video introducing the law of sine and a link to my webpage that has all my old videos for law of sine and cosine, applications of law of cosine like bearing problems and such. And this time, we're going to actually try and make this video without a sine error. So thank you very much, Brian, for pointing that out. At least this original video was only up for about 10 hours before someone got my sine error. Okay, so we're going to do a little bit of review to begin with. First of all, in part A, we have, that was a good catch, we have a triangle where we have all three sides, but we don't know any of the measure of the angles. So this information is given to us in a side-side-side pattern. That's a congruency theorem that you learned in geometry, which means that these three sides, if I'm giving you these three sides, are kind of assumed to make a triangle. I mean, it's not like it's a length of 6 and 1 that don't even reach to a length of 8. And since that's a congruency theorem, one triangle, we don't have like an ambiguous case. Like we might have sometimes using when we need to start our problem with the law of sine. And we have another problem here of side B is 2, side C is 90, angle C is 96 degrees, and side A is 3. And it's never a good idea to start a geometry problem without, well, this is effectively arguably trig, but it's applied to sort of a geometry situation. It's not good to start these without having a picture. So I'm going to just draw a triangle, not be concerned about drawing it to scale, just something where I can say, oh, let's let this be angle A, this be angle B, this be angle C. Side B, which is opposite angle B, has a length of 2. Side A, opposite of angle A, has a length of 3. And angle C is 96 degrees. And we're doing this now also to identify, do we have information given to us in the pattern of a congruency theorem from geometry, which we do, side, angle, side. And this is going to help us in a couple of ways. It's going to help us determine whether we start these problems with law of sine or law of cosine, and it's also going to be a reminder as to whether we have just, you know, a triangle that we're solving for, or if we have an ambiguous situation where it's side-side angle. Spell that backwards. It's not a good word, right? side-side angle is not a congruency theorem in geometry, which opens the door for us to not even possibly have a solution or actually have two triangles that we need to solve for. Well, as we spoke about in our previous lesson, for applying or starting these problems with the law of sine, we have to know information about a side and the angle opposite to that side. And we don't have that situation in either one of these scenarios, so both of these need to be started with the law of cosine. Okay, so that is we have a side squared is equal to the other two sides squared and added together, minus 2 times those other two sides, times the cosine of A. Your textbook is probably going to be giving you three equations for the law of cosine. I say this because they just have one where it's set equal to A squared, one set equal to B squared, and one set equal to C squared. Instead of remembering three formulas for the law of cosine, A side squared, not the letter A, but just a particular side squared, is equal to the other two sides squared added together, minus 2 times those other two sides, times the cosine of the angle, which is opposite the side that it's basically set up to equal. Not exactly equal to the sine, but the side squared. Your textbook probably also gives you a version for the law of cosine identity, or formulas that are set equal to the cosine of the angle, like cosine of A, cosine of B, cosine of C. I would suggest that you don't necessarily try to memorize those. It's just why remember basically six formulas when you can kind of just remember one. Another reason is they move these terms of, well, in this case, B squared and C squared over with subtraction, divide by negative 2B, and then for some reason they always simplify the denominator, and instead of showing it as a division of negative 2BC, they show it as a division of positive 2BC. That means you have to apply a multiplication of negative 1 through the numerator, and it messes up the signs. And a lot of times when kids try to memorize that version of the formula, they make a sign error, and they miss a problem that they shouldn't otherwise miss. Now, with all of that being said, one more thing, one more review caveat piece of information before we get started. We did not have to find any angle measures for our oblique triangles in our first lesson because we were using the law of sine and the information was given such that we just didn't need to. When you start trying to find missing angles in oblique triangles, you need to be really careful because, well, the inverse sine of y over r, or opposite over hypotenuse, but we like y over r and the labels of x, y, and r when we're dealing with angles in standard position, is going to give you some kind of angle measure. And we need to remember that that angle measure that we get out of the inverse sine function is going to be between the measurements of, well, theta is greater than or equal to negative 90 degrees and less than or equal to positive 90 degrees, not 99, or negative pi over 2 and positive pi over 2 if you're working with radians, which means that you cannot find the measure of an obtuse angle with inverse sine. If you are going to be looking for this angle C, and this angle happens to be 93 degrees, and you try and find it with inverse sine, you're going to be, because sine is an even function, instead of being told that the angle is obtuse, say 93 degrees, the inverse sine function is going to tell you that it's 87 degrees, where 93 and 87 degrees are both either 3 degrees off the y-axis, but that doesn't have like a really special name, or they both have a reference angle of 87 degrees. That'll throw you off. You won't know that you've gotten the wrong answer. So never ever use law of sine to find an angle measure that's opposite the largest side of a triangle. If it's such that that angle was supposed to be obtuse, you would get an acute answer and continue the problem without ever realizing that you had made an error. So, and it's technically sort of not an error, it's just a limitation of inverse sine. Now when you do inverse cosine, the angle you get from that is going to be an angle that is between 0 and 180 degrees. So if the angle is obtuse, you're going to get it, like we're about to do right now. We're going to start here with saying that 8 squared is equal to the other two sides squared and added together. So 6 squared plus 5 squared minus 2 times 6 times 5 times the cosine of C. Now, we're going to bring the 6 squared and the 5 squared over to the left-hand side with subtraction. We're going to divide both sides of this equation by basically negative 60, right? 6 times 5 is 30, times 2 is negative 60. Now here's where I flubbed up my first lesson and made a sine error. We have 8 squared, which is 64, minus 6 squared, which is 36, minus 5 squared, which is 25. I even reread my work, but because I did it, you kind of don't catch it as well. We have 64 minus 30. Is what? 34. Now 34 minus 20 is 14. We've got 14 minus 6, which is 8, and we have 8 minus 5, which is equal to 3, not negative 3, like I wrote in my initial recording of this video. Then we have that divided by negative 60, so we're looking at negative 1/20th, and let's go ahead and find out what C is by applying the inverse cosine function to both sides. So C is equal to the arc cosine, or the inverse cosine, depending on the book you're using. It means the same thing. And that is going to come out to be, this time typing it in correctly, 92.8, let's round it off to the nearest tenth, 92.9 degrees. Okay. Now see, if I found that later, using the law of sine, I would get basically about 87 degrees, not the correct measure angle of 92.9 degrees. Now, as Brian pointed out, I was teaching by example. I told you, if possible, don't ever do another part to your problem with information that you found on your own, because if you do, you're going to carry that error on to the next piece of information. So when we go to find angle A, if I used the law of cosine and for some reason did something silly like wrote negative 3 instead of positive 3 instead of negative 3 here, if that angle now is wrong because of a silly mistake, I'm going to get the wrong answer for angle A. So if I don't want to take an error and carry it forward, I can, well, just start fresh again with the given information and say that we have 5. We're going to review law of sine in the next problem, though, by the way, so don't worry about that. Where'd my blue chalk go? We have 5 squared is equal to 6 squared plus 8 squared minus 2 times 6 times 8 times the cosine of A. And same thing, we're going to have 5 squared minus 6 squared minus 8 squared over negative 2 times 6 times 8 is equal to the cosine of A. And another cautionary note with these problems, a little bit of round-off error can affect and spiral into larger and larger sort of small errors, becoming large errors, as you work through the multiple parts of your triangle. It's really best, I can do 25 minus 36 minus 64 in my head. At least that's what I thought yesterday. At any rate. But I'm going to have to grab the calculator at some point regardless. And especially now that we have all these fancy 84, even like a black and white 84. Back in my day, you had to get all that syntax super correct. You can type this in your calculator exactly how you're writing it. And then you don't have any round-off error. Like, don't take this decimal, like this numerator, and then divide by the denominator and round that, and then do the inverse cosine and round that, and maybe if there's another step, round that. It can throw off your answer by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 degrees when really you're doing everything just perfectly fine. So don't do that. Second, cosine alpha y equals to open up the fraction menu. And here we go. And we get A is angle A. The measure of angle A is equal to 38.6 degrees. Now, for our remaining angle, of course, we know that we have to have measurements that add up to 180 degrees. So we have 180 minus 92.9 minus 38.6. Let's just not grab our calculator for every single little piece of arithmetic we have to do. Like in universities, they don't even allow calculators in calculus. We have 180 minus 90 is 90. We have 90 minus 30, which is 60. Now we're down to what? 60 minus 2 is 58. Now we're down to 50. Now we're down to 49.1 and 48.5 as we take away that 0.6. Now, I don't want to put out another video with a small error, so even though I'm saying practice your arithmetic, mental arithmetic, we're going to check. Fantastic. Okay, now, part B. We're going to have to start this problem, just because the way the information is given, find the length of side C first. So, once again, A side squared is equal to the other two sides squared and added together. So we're going to have 3 squared plus 2 squared minus 2 times those other two sides times the cosine of the angle. Measure that angle that's opposite the side that you're working with. So the cosine of 96 degrees. And that's going to be C squared is equal to, we've got, again, I just said we could type all this in the calculator, but let's go ahead and just walk through this. We have 9 plus 4, which is 13, minus 6 times 2, which is 12, and C is then equal to the square root of this, and that is equal to 3.8 units. Double check. 3.78, 3.8. Fantastic. We're going to go to the nearest tenths place. Now that we know that the length of C is equal to approximately 3.8, let's do a review of law of sine. So we are going to find the measure of, let's say, angle B, using the law of sine, because now we know a side and the measure of the angle opposite that side. We also know that angle B is not opposite the largest side of the triangle, therefore there's no possibility for it to be an obtuse angle. So we have, and because we're looking for an angle measure, I'm going to put the sine of B on top, so we have the sine of B over 2 is equal to the sine of 96 degrees over 3.8. We're going to multiply both sides by 2 and have the sine of B is 2 sine of 96 degrees over 3.8. Take the inverse sine of both sides, and the measure of angle B is equal to the arc sine. I'm going to write this just in case your book is using it. This is the same as inverse sine of 2 times the sine of 96 degrees over 3.8. I keep using the degree notation because you will be eventually working with radians if you have not already. And that's how you tell whether or not you're working with a degree measure or a radian measure. Use the degree notation. And that comes out to be 31.6 degrees. And one more time for angle A, then the measure of angle A is going to be, well, the result of doing 180 minus 31.6 minus 96. Working through this in our head one more time, we have 180 minus 90 is 90 degrees. Now we're down to 90 minus 30 is 60. 59. 59 minus 6 is what? 53. And now 53 minus 0.6 is 52.4 degrees. And that is how you, hope you enjoy your introduction to the law of cosine one more time. Links to old videos and application for law of sine and cosine are in the description. I'm Mr. True. Bam! Go do your homework.